About ready?
Yeah.
Speak.
I know that as a child you spent a lot of time in boxes. Can you tell us a little bit about the significance of boxes in your early childhood?
One of my childhood memories, which has something to do with possibly to do with the writing I did later, is I used to love to take a cardboard box and sit in it and pull the lid over it and pretend that I was on some sort of vessel. I doubt that it was a spaceship I was thinking of in those days, more likely an ocean-going ship. But I would get I would sit in there and dream about what was going on. This troubled my parents considerably, because I know my father said to my mother, as he said many other times, we may not have this boy with us all his life. He does strange things, and you might have noticed, Glenn, that he likes to sit in boxes with the lid pulled down over them.
What are some other strange things you did as a child?
Well, I lived a lot of my life as a child was lived in worlds of dreams and books. I was very fortunate that my mother wanted me to be able to read when I went to school. And so in those days, the library was the way of educating a child and teaching him imagination and reading. And so we went to the local library on the streetcar about every Friday night. And we all took a full load of books and came home. And I used to love to curl up with a book. And I led, as a child, a life of a dream life. I was very fortunate, in view of my later interest in science fiction, that there were a couple of people that contributed to my dream life. One was an ex-convict from San Quentin. I've learned since that convicts spend a lot of dream life time too. And he introduced me to John Carter of Mars, Edgar Rice Burroughs, who I consider, from the point of view of imagination and writing, just a phenomenal creative man. Another person that contributed was a boy named Claude, who had even more physical problems than I had, who was a science fiction fan, and he loaned me copies of his amazing stories. And wow, what an exciting discovery that was. And in those days, I read some of the greats, without knowing they were greats as they are today, but E.E. Smith and so on.
Who were your favorite childhood heroes?
Well, there was the usual collection. As a small child, my heroes were likely to be muscular people of daring do and great bravery and great courage, physical bravery and courage. As I grew older, there were other things that I considered brave too, to stand up for ideas and that sort of thing. But I had a succession of heroes all through my life, from novels and from literature.
What do you remember most about your childhood?
I remember from my childhood that I was a loner. I don't know that that's necessarily the best thing to want a person's child to be, but circumstances made me a loner. I think the circumstances of having disabilities as a young child, which I later conquered and grew out of. Also, I think that one thing that made me a loner was the fact that in teaching me to read, Mother, without knowing it, had me skip grades, because reading is often what a teacher judges on what grade a child should be in. And so I was always a year or two younger than my classmates, and that's very difficult for a child. I imagine it's just as difficult for a girl, with the growing of breasts and all of that. With a boy, it is certainly difficult, because your musculature is not up to the rest of the boys, and you cannot climb a rope hand over hand like guys a year later can do. And this stunts your social development. And Yeah, and you're scoffed at a lot. Children are cruel. They're little animals, healthy little animals. They're as cruel as your puppies are to each other. And I've often heard, Gene can't do this. Oh, well, don't let Gene pitch. He can't throw the ball that far. Difficult times.
What is your happiest childhood memory?
My happiest childhood memories are usually things of the mind. That's for actually childhood. Discoveries of books, of characters, of... tumbling through my mind now are all sorts of discoveries of characters and fictional heroes and so on. Later on, my happy moments became more real things. As a very young man, my happy moments are associated with things like the day I got to solo a Porterfield 65 horsepower airplane, and the first time I dared to go up in loop-a-loop. And as is happening to my 14-year-old son now, memories of certain girls I met. There are some happy things academically. Little victories. I guess when you're younger than your classmates and you need little victories. And I selfishly was very happy because the teacher said, next year we're going to study physiology, and we'll be studying the bones of the body and so on. And I troubled to memorize all the bones in the human body. I recall there are 207 of them. And so I waited, little bastard that I was, till he called on me, and I went up, picked up the pointer, and named all of the bones. And I remember what he said. He said, Gene Roddenberry, go to the library. He didn't want that kind of revolutionary in his class. He was this was a good teacher and a fun teacher because he would give me assignments for, if I was noisy in class, he would give me an assignment, as I recall he did, on cooperation. And I went to the library and looked up the term gregariousness and wrote a little essay on gregariousness, in which I got out of a book the fact the human species could not survive without gregariousness and so on. And he got a friend of mine, Dean Scurr, to read it. And he said, Scurr, do you know what gregariousness is? And Scurr said, hell no, neither did anyone else. I only learned it from the library recently. He said, Gene Roddenberry, I predict that you will end hung to a lamppost by all these savages here. And the savages, of course, cheered. That was kind of fun. If you can't compete in football, you compete in your own way.
What was your most important school accomplishment?
School accomplishment. I had a very happy first 3 years of college in which I was very active in the school and I was on the student council and had a good grade average. What were my accomplishments there? Let me start this one over.
High school. Start from elementary school to high school.
As far as school accomplishments, I had no particular accomplishments in elementary school. In high school, as the years went by and the year or year and a half discrepancy in ages became smaller physically, I did have some accomplishments and did make close friends. And remember being president of the Spanish Club and the Junto Club. One of my brother's memories, he's 2 years younger than I am, but he got to be president of the Spanish Club. He came home and told them about it excitedly, and either mother or dad said, yes, Gene did that 2 years ago. And he said he really hated me for doing those things first. I had more accomplishments, I think, in college because difference in physical age became even slimmer. And I joined the swimming team, and I led a more normal life, a more social life.
What are your memories about your parents?
I have memories of my parents that are pleasant. For example, I realized recently that my memories about my parents are very pleasant. I've been aware for some time that in my family and in my life, I've never been one to my memories about my parents are very pleasant. Somehow I grew up not thinking about race, religion, prejudice, and those things. And in recent years, I've realized it had to be my parents who began that way of philosophy, that way of life for me. And as I look back and think about it, I never heard the parents mention Jew or Guinea or Polak or anything like that. People were people to them, and it became that way naturally to me. And I think that's unusual because my parents were middle-class Southerners who might, in their social strata, might have been expected to have a ordinary group of prejudices, as were true of people in those days. I'm talking about the 20s and 30s, but they were unusual. It had to be in order to bring children up feeling that way. Although I never remember any lecturing on it. It was just the way they lived, and I don't remember a lecture on tolerance or anything like that.
You mentioned that you were from the South. How did you get to California?
My father was born in Georgia, Folkston, Georgia, a small town, hardly more than a wide spot in the road. As a matter of fact, Roddenberrys are very common in Georgia because the first senator from Georgia was a Roddenberry, and there was a Thad Roddenberry who won a land grant in Georgia during the Revolutionary War. So at least that part of our background is proudly Yankee. My father was lost his parents when he was a child. I think he had a very, very tough life, which to me magnifies his every accomplishment. And he ended up joining the cavalry. And the cavalry was a cruel service in pre-World War I days. And I'm sure he was beaten and bullied. As a matter of fact, before he died, he was asked if he wanted a military burial, which he was entitled to as a World War I soldier. And he said, no, I don't want my death to have anything to do with the military. He went to El Paso, Texas. He joined the cavalry. The cavalry had a post at Fort Bliss. He was in the Border Patrol in Texas in those days. He met my mother before World War I. Then he went in World War I to Europe, and when he came back, he married this little dark-haired girl of 16 who he had met when she was 14. And they lived in El Paso for a couple of years, but times were tough. After World War I, there was a Great Depression, at least in Texas there was. Jobs were very scarce. They were having tough times. My father, again, an unusual thing, went to California. He went there on the rails. He wore a business suit under his coveralls, hoping that the railroad police wouldn't treat him too badly when they caught him as a tramp, and went to California, joined the Los Angeles Police Department, lying about a number of things, including the fact he could drive. And after a year or so, he was able to send my mother enough money that she could bring me an 18-month-old boy, a child, infant really, out to California on the train. And we lived in limited circumstances, but as things bettered for him. I remember some happy times. I remember him buying a Model T. And not many people see those today, or some people don't know what they are. He had one. He was very proud of it. I remember that in 1931, he bought a brand new Chevrolet for, I think it was $890. And our first car, which he was very proud of. I remember him being terribly, after having the background he had, he was very proud of his home. He was proud of the flower beds and how things look and how he kept it up. And in fact, when I was going to high school, I remember somebody stopping at the front of the house and saying they were on the way to, he was on his way to his wife's grave. And he just so admired some of those flowers. Could he just pick a few to leave at the grave? I remember my father being very happy about that. And I know the family today, their children.
Tell us a little bit about your brothers and sisters.
My brothers and sisters were born after we came to California. My brother is 2 years younger than me. I very well remember my sister's birth. She's about 4.5 or 5 years younger than me. And they are living as of this date and very happy. My brother is a big, 2 inches taller than I am. I'm pleased that he is called among our friends the good Roddenberry. And he is a marvelous person. We, all of us, hug and kiss when we meet. We're very fond of each other. And my sister equally. She has been married, is not now. She lives with my mother. And that's very fortunate for all of us because she is able to take care of my mother who's in her 80s now. And it's a very happy arrangement. Sis, I think, could have been a writer. She used to make up poetry much better than I could. And I think she, the reason she didn't become a writer, I think, is a typical problem of the 30s with girls. Girls were supposed to be housewives. They were not supposed to be writers. If a girl did poetry, isn't that a cute accomplishment? But no one would seriously say to them in many families, you should study and attempt to make use of this fine mind you have. Fine cooking and fine bodies were all girls were expected to have. And in some of my writings today, I try to get on this subject because living there in those days, it never occurred to me that there was any other way. And even today, I know that I still have male-female prejudices, which I must fight hard to overcome. Particularly in a Southern family, you have women are rated very low, except for cooking and housekeeping and taking care of children.
Yeah, I knew. I heard it coming.
Is it going all right? Where have you got me? Medium shot?
Different. He's changing
I'm
shot.
I'm moving around.
And okay. That's why I'm waiting a little bit.
We may want to stick a pillow behind you instead
okay.
of underneath you.
Try that.
Yeah, yes.
Try that.
Yeah, when I'm hesitating for a question, it's not because I don't know what I'm going to say. It's I'm watching and I'm waiting for him to get his shot.
Okay.
And
go ahead.
When he gets his, when I see that he stops.
Well, I'll wait for you. And
I'm just waiting to see to give him some. Am I doing okay, or do I need to give you more time?
Yeah.
Okay, I was trying to watch to make sure.
No, it doesn't matter. It's okay on there. Guys, I'd like to discuss a few things I'd like my children to remember, advice for them, affection being one of them. Don't be afraid of affection.
My next question coming up is I was getting ready to ask you about the environment in your family. What kind of affection?
And then I'd like to...
But we can also do that at the end, too.
cut it into the end.
Or we can cut it into the end. Yes. That was my next question out of my mouth.
And I'd like to tell them to be their own person.
Mm-hmm.
To, that's a good thought.
Yeah. Don't be afraid of having their own opinions, even though they're different from other people's. I remember perhaps the one time I spanked my older daughter was when she was carrying a notebook with when Brown versus Nixon was going on in California. And she was carrying a Brown thing, and Pat Brown is a friend. And then she changed it for Nixon because all of her girlfriends were for Nixon. And shouldn't have spanked her for that, but I wanted so much to say, be your own person. But going the way they go is usually the wrong way to go.
Did your family, when you were growing up, have a lot of affection
for each
other?
Are we on
now?
Yes, go ahead.
When you were growing up as a child, did your family show a lot of affection for each other?
Our family showed the amount of affection Southern families usually showed. It was not excessive laying on of hands. We all loved each other, and I think everyone made it clear they did. In my family, we show more. We tend to touch more and kiss more. We do not feel that the laying on of hands necessarily means you're unnatural toward your children or toward male and female. And I'd like my children to always do. We're a strange combination. We're about half animal, and we're about half God, is in my opinion. And we humans, we must also massage our animal part. And the animal part does require touching and affection and these things. I remember I wrote something once about the fact that the human being has got his toes in the mud and his heart and soul high in the heavens, but that the mud is important. It is the mud between our toes that allows us to dance. And we must be all of those things. And so I think we've got to massage all of the parts of ourselves.
What did you want to be when you were growing up?
I wanted to be an airline pilot. That was from the first time I looked at an airplane in the sky. I was fascinated by them. I built model airplanes as a kid. I studied them. I joined a club in which we used to pretend that we were flying radio beams with blindfolded and with a pencil. And one fellow on one side, we were going da-da, da-da. The other side, we were going da-dit, da-dit, which is the way the old beams worked. I got into the CPT, civilian pilot training, which the government was doing before the war, realizing that probably we would go to war and need pilots. And I got my private license through CPT, my advanced license, acrobatics, and so on. And I never had a happier day in my life than when I joined the Air Corps before the war, before World War II, but was not called in until the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor. And then on the 18th of December, 1941, I was shipped off to Texas to begin my flight training. And as a devoted hater of war, I'm sorry to say that the happiest day of my life was when I found myself shipped off to war to become a pilot. That's all I ever wanted to do in those days. Then when war was over, and I became a pilot for Pan American World Airways, and flying was a little more sedate, and you didn't exactly buzz cows as you in a Pan American Clipper. Then I began to sour a bit on it, and then realized that what I had let myself into was to become an international bus driver. And there's not a lot of intellectual excitement in flying an airplane. Once you've learned all of your altitudes and all of your rules and regulations, you generally sit there strapped to a seat with the airplane on autopilot, wishing you could go back and talk to a passenger.
What did it feel like the first time you ever flew an airplane?
What
did it feel like the first time you flew an airplane by yourself?
Yes, I remember that. The first time I flew an airplane by myself, it was a feeling of such exhilaration. I'd already gotten that feeling when I had done 6 hours, I think, of tandem flight with an instructor, and some of it began then. But when you get into an airplane by yourself and you take off and you're in this lovely three-dimensional world, you can go in any direction. And you go up in there. In those days, at least, the air was clean. There is just no feeling any more exciting than that. Freedom, freedom, freedom. That's the feeling you get. And my second sensuous experience having to do that was the first time I flew at night. And I remember so well, because in those days also the air was clear, and over my head was this canopy of stars, like jewels in a cathedral, diamonds in a cathedral, and below me were all the jewels of the earth, the reds and the greens and all the lights down there, piled up and shining and sparkling. And it's a pity that the air doesn't stay clear these days, because it just literally takes your breath away, the sheer beauty of it.
I'm going to change your sound. Okay. Did anything unusual or frightening ever happen to you when you were flying an airplane?
Well, flying was a mixture of good things to me and bad things. Obviously not too bad, because I'm alive today. It was just a stream of consciousness running through my flying days. It was a great victory to me personally to get through cadets and not be washed out. So many boys in those days were. It was a great victory to be able to pass the physical examination. As I said, in my childhood I was somewhat handicapped. I couldn't see in bright sunlight, and I had asthma and so on. The miracle of adolescence for me was that all those things went away. And I remember four of us went down to take the exams for the Air Corps, and I was the only one who passed in all counts. It's the miracle of the body changes of adolescence. And I remember the joy of doing that, the joy of passing. Do you want to get a fresh shot, and I'll start over fresh on a new part of that?
Okay. Have you ever had a close call in an airplane?
Yes, I've had some. Of course, I had close calls too in airplanes. They were in combat in the Pacific. Had its share of, my combat had a share of Japanese Zeros coming in our formations. Can I just, mm-hmm. We take a break for a minute and
yes.
Get my mind together?
Are you searching for his crash in the desert? Plan for that question?
Eventually. I'll wait. There might have been another one or something else that might have been as important. So that's why I didn't even ask about that one specifically.
Yeah. That'd be
okay.
Crowding to me.
Yes.
My flying experience was basically a happy one. I remember the joy of going overseas. And I went over, supposed to be a pursuit pilot, a fighter pilot, as they call it in those days, but in the Pacific, in those early days of the Pacific War, they had few fighter airplanes that could go more than 300 miles, and that wasn't very good in island hopping. And I remember being told I'd have to take some other specialty, and I was in a headquarters over in Hawaii, And I read a Life magazine article about B-17s always come back. And it looked good to me, so I went down and volunteered for a B-17 squadron. And that's what I was sent into combat was in B-17s. It was early in the war. The Japanese had superiority in the air. Their Zeros were just a marvelous airplane. And yes, I recall many episodes of being up on bombing missions and having Zeros belly roll in at us with their guns going, and you shrink behind your wheel and wish you could get thinner. And but somehow when you're young, as every politician knows, you have no fear of death, and really no, when you have more to lose, you feel that you won't lose it. You certainly won't die. And I don't remember an awful lot of fear, although I don't remember being a hero either. I was not gung-ho. I didn't feel that I was on the front line of America's defense. Perhaps I'd read too much. I always felt there were some really phony things about the war, but since they said the boys had to go and I was a boy, what the hell? Why not go? And as I say, it had its enjoyable aspects. When my buddies from those days and I get together and talk, we spend most of our time laughing over funny things that happened. I did lose some airplanes, two, toward the latter part of my flying experience. I flew 87 missions, and even then I don't remember it too badly. We crashed both times, a controlled crash, because I had an aversion to us bailing out over Pacific waters where there were sharks. I did have a friend that bailed out, and the sharks almost got him, but he broke his arm in the bailout, and so with only one hand available, he couldn't unfasten his chute, and it floating around mercifully kept him from sharks until he was rescued by a coast watcher. But I didn't have that problem. I think the scariest things that ever happened to me came some years later when I was flying for Pan America, Pan American World Airways. I was heading back from Calcutta, and I was deadheading back. I was not one of the pilots of the plane. I checked somebody out in a navigation route, and we lost our number one engine. And I was flying at the time. I had taken the wheel for a while. The pilot, Joe Hart, who was killed in it, was a friend. And I said, you know, you guys rest. I'm bored, so I'll fly for a while. And I remember us discussing that maybe we'd go to Ankara instead of Istanbul, because it was a little lower route to Ankara. And we lost number one engine. I called him up. We weren't worried. The Constellation, which is what this was, an L-049, flew very well on three engines. And I went back and went to sleep. And I remember I was wakened by the alarm bell. I opened the curtains of the bunk, and it looked like the whole left side of the airplane was on fire. What had happened is the number two engine, which is the one nearest the cockpit there, had blown its, had thrown out its, burst its bearings, and they had cut the oil and fuel lines aft of where they can be stopped, and it was spewing oil, gasoline over the engine, and we ultimately crashed in the desert. We were at 21,000 feet, and it just seemed to take forever to get down. And as a supernumerary, it saved my life. I was a supernumerary because there was panic in the cabin, and I can understand why. There certainly was in the cockpit, although controlled. And in my heart, there certainly was. And I remember walking down the aisle of the airplane, trying to tell people in as calm as possible a voice that it looks worse than it is, that we know where we're going to land below, and we know what we're doing. And I was in the third to last row of seats when the airplane hit. My images of that are looking out a window, seeing the cartwheel for a quarter mile across the desert. I remember a great flaming pool of gasoline. I a glimpse of bodies writhing in the fire as they were burning. And nine of us got out. And something happened to me that had a big influence on my life. As we were coming down, and death was absolutely certain, I was thinking all sorts of things. Scratch a message to my wife in the middle, you know. Well, what am I going to say? I love you. She knew that. I thought, well, maybe you just ought to pray. And I remember thinking that, wait a minute, you don't ordinarily pray, and I wouldn't have much respect for a God that would accept your prayers when you were in dire straits like this. He bound to judge you on, if he's judging you on what you did in ordinary times as well as, he just wouldn't accept prayers. And so I remember making up my mind not to pray. I just said, okay, take me as I am. And I've always been rather proud of that, that you might call that dire emergency. And if you believe something in a dire emergency, it's probably what you truly believe. But it was an interesting, if you live through experiences like that, it was a very interesting experience. I had, we were rescued by Arabs. I had to make friends with them. And it was so interesting experience. I've never written a story about it because it just seems too, real life sometimes gets too phony to translate into fiction. You wouldn't believe it in fiction. I wouldn't believe the sun coming up on the desert and the survivors crouched there and a young man from India suggesting that he imagined that many religions represented, various people would like to pray thanks in their own way. I couldn't write that scene. No one would believe that scene, sun coming up, and it just seemed so phony. But the experience was full of those things.
Were you injured?
No.
Real change.
Oh, real. Did we go through, have we already been through another real attack? Okay.
Hey, that was a good piece.
Story coming.
I can imagine. I can't imagine going through that. I mean, you'd have to experience.
Yeah. What we find out about ourselves is we're capable of much more than we
realize. Yeah.
I'd like to tell my children that too. I relate these experiences because I'd like my children to understand, and anyone else who cares to listen, that there really is no such thing as bravery, that we humans are capable of all sorts of things, given the circumstances. I was trapped into doing certain things as being the surviving officer of that crew. And there was no bravery involved. You just do what you have to do, and all humans are capable of that. In different circumstances, I could have easily been a sniveling coward. And with different feelings. So I'd like to say to my children, have a certain pride in yourself. You probably will be surprised at what you're capable of. And don't be judgmental about yourself. I'm so anxious that you don't look on these experiences that I happen to blunder into and say, well, that's my dad. I couldn't do that because what the hell you couldn't.
You've had a number of different careers in your life. After you got out of college, were in the service, what did you do?
After college?
After the service.
After Pan American.
Yeah, after Pan American.
When I quit Pan American because I decided I didn't want to be an international bus driver, and the thing I decided I would try is writing. Everyone considers themselves a would-be writer, and in this case I happened to make it. I didn't go directly to writing. A friend of mine, a writer who had written some novels, said to me, you don't know enough about life really to be a writer about Gene. You've seen the Pan American has shown you the world in some depth, but How do you know how it is on the streets and how people under pressure and bad circumstances really act? So I joined the Los Angeles Police Department because he said become a reporter or a cop to learn these things. And I didn't know how to become a reporter. To be a cop, I paid $2. I took the exam. And I'll never regret those 5.5 years I spent on the police department because you do see a lot of life and not only in the ghetto, but in the rich parts of town. You learn that blacks are being picked up on Skid Row for gambling with dice, whereas whites in their country clubs are playing dice and attended by servants and so on, and they're never arrested, even though far more money is at stake. And probably as much or more cheating that goes on in country club card games. So you do get a lot of perspective on life. I began writing first stories for Dragnet since I was on the police department. I learned that Jack Webb would pay $100 for a story that he could make into a script. Well, having been studying writing as I was doing, I saw why a lot of these stories that my friends on the department sold or wanted to sell weren't being sold. I said to them, why not bring your stories to me and tell them to me, and then I will write them up in such a fact that they have the ingredients that a television show needs, and we'll split the money. And indeed, for a long time, I made what seemed to me incredible amounts of money, sometimes a couple $100 a week, sharing the story credits, sharing the money with my friends. And then at last I tried for a writing assignment. Did only so-so on the first. The second one got better. After I'd written about my fourth, I remember seeing a memo from the head of the studio, which was Ziv Studios at the time. We want to put some money into Roddenberry's story because we think it'll make a good film. And from then on, fortunately, I kept improving. And I became known as one of the better freelance writers around the country. And I began making more money, getting more credits, and good days. I ended up, finally, the end of that run was, I was head writer for Have Gun, Will Travel. From there on, I ran on to writing some pilots, which didn't sell, but I thought I saw why. And so I said to myself, if I'm going to write pilot films, and I should then become a producer so I could put into them the actors I want, have them done the way I want them to be, and by good fortune that worked too. And as a producer, I began to acquire some little credit. I then produced Star Trek, which was not a hit, understand. It was, in fact, it was considered something of a failure of its 3 years. But, of course, in the long run, it didn't turn out to be. And I should say to my children another thing. People talk about stick-to-itiveness, actually cultivate stubbornness. Screw them, I'll stick with it. And that will get you a long way on a lot of things, too.
What are some of your favorite stories that you've written?
What I like about writing is, and that's particularly come true with Star Trek, is you're able to say to the world the things you believe and feel strongly about. And I think everyone believes and feels strongly about things. Most people can only talk about it to their friends or their golf club or to their buddies at work or their friends, their women friends. As a writer, you can look at the whole world and say, I think I'll comment on selfishness, or I think I'll comment on greed, or I think I'll comment on any subject. In Star Trek, I was able to comment on diversity, the beauty of diversity, the fact the world has so many diverse elements, and we should be pleased that the world has diversity rather than longing that everything be the same. And so the joy of, oh, I was leading to the fact that what I believe art is comment. Whether you work in marble and stone or painting on a canvas or music or what, the whole point of art is you comment on a certain thing. When Rembrandt did a painting, he was saying, this is how I see this fields and these flowers and so on. And each painter in a different way. Some commented on the riots of color that there is in the world. Some saw the world as geometric shapes. All of it is comment. There's great art is not made just by beauty and detail. It is what you're saying. And of course, my writing, and particularly writing in the field of words, it gives you great opportunity. I have some things I'm happy about. When we started Star Trek, we had a script come in about a monster. It was our first BEM, bug-eyed monster. And I remember saying to the writer, let's not do it that way. Let's show that even monsters have their point of view. And we wrote a show about some miners on a planet that were being killed by in their underground where they were digging for a certain precious substance. And in these underground tunnels that they were digging, they found a lot of round black objects. Well, the point of the story were these were the eggs of something that lived underground, and the reason they were killing the miners was to protect their eggs and their young. And this was a happy thought because it set the tone for all of Star Trek. Even when we talk about villains, we try to see it a little bit from their point of view too. We had a very ugly villains called the Klingons, but we also wrote about the Klingon pride in being warriors and the codes that they lived by, which were different than ours, diversity, but they lived by them, and in that way they were sort of noble things. So writing is get the joy of comment. A lot of people, when you talk about this Bali, I've said to people that, can you imagine how great it is to sit there and be able to propagandize a whole nation? And they have, because propaganda has negative tones, so I've seen them shake their head and frown and say, oh God, what an awful thing to have happen. No, it's not an awful thing, because I propagandize for what I believe in. Every other writer and every other person has all the rights in the world to come along and say, he is crazy, here is the way it really is. And another one can say, no, this is the way things are. And it is out of this that our civilization is built, and values and judgment. I take great pleasure out of it.
I need you to go over the first part about the part that led up to your first bug-eyed monster. We had a little bit for you.
Okay.
Grab there.
I remember on Star Trek, one of my great joys came out of the fact that someone had written a script about bug-eyed monsters, miners on a planet who were being killed in their underground tunnels they had built. There was in these tunnels also round items, very hard. And what it turns out were these round items were the eggs of a creature that lived underground. And the creatures were killing the miners to protect their young.
Okay, got that.
Mm-hmm. Star Trek has, in many ways, to me, been an advanced degree college education, because being called upon in order to devise the stories, to look at humankind and saying, what are we? What are we about? And you're looking for those things in the 25th century just as much as you are in the 20th. It has forced me to read and study and think. One of the happiest things that happened to me was after Star Trek was first on the air, it was considered a failure, and so I was forced to go out and lecture at colleges to pay our mortgage. But in doing that, I was able then to continue studying and for these lectures to talk about things that later became subject for later Star Trek scripts. So it has been a course in humankind for me. Of the things I'm happiest about in my life is the fact that I go on learning. I'm in my 60s now, and one of the joys is every day that you're finding out about something new and different. What an exciting world this is. I feel sorry for people who are shrugging and saying, well, it's all over for me, I've done my thing. I'm still wondering, I suppose, what I'm going to be when I grow up. And I hope it continues that way, always. And I advised, again, my children to cultivate this attitude. It's just like the world is an amusement park, and it continues to be that way for as long as you live.
What would you like to do that you haven't done?
Among the things I would like to do, I've done enough things that I'm reasonably happy and I'm reasonably pleased with myself. I think Gene Roddenberry is a pretty good guy, considering where he came from and his weaknesses and other things. I think he's a pretty good guy. And so I'm not really burning with ambition to prove anything by doing other things. I just want new experiences. I'll tell you a story about there are some things that happen to you when you become well-known because of your writing. I carry gasoline credit cards that say E.W. Roddenberry, for Eugene Wesley Roddenberry, my full name. And occasionally I'll get gas at a station, the attendant will look at the name and he'll say, oh, right, do you know Gene Roddenberry? And I will say, that is my greatest ambition, to really get to know him. And they'll usually say, well, if you do, say hello for me. But I am getting to know him, and it's fun.
You mentioned when we were talking about stories about having strong beliefs and the ability to say things to people. What are some of Gene Roddenberry's personal strong beliefs?
Some of my personal beliefs revolve around the fact I consider the human race to be a child race. Right now, we're far from an adult race. All you have to do is pick up the morning paper and glance over the headlines to see that that's not true. But I am in love. I'm in love with the human race. I think the human animal is really a fine animal. This combination of fur and nakedness. I'm really proud of them, from where they've come from, being an hairy ape, an Australopithecus, to what they've done now, just staggers me. The fact that here we are, able to look back at the beginning of the universe, and through our science, we have echoes of the Big Bang that happened, what was it, 15 billion years ago, they say, and in which there were just hydrogen molecules, and this great explosion happened. However, science later turns out that it did happen, which released time and gravity and all of these things, and everything expanded outward, complexifying. Simple molecules became more and more complex molecules till it became not only our galaxy but all the galaxies. And in the midst of this race and this confusion has developed this creature who 15 billion years later is able to look back and figure out what the beginning was. Now, that is a hell of an accomplishment for a bunch of hydrogen molecules that were let loose. What is behind it? I can only give my feelings are that I don't believe in the usual personal God. I do feel there is a gigantic plan afoot, probably more complex than anything you can ever get into holy books, and which we're not even wise enough to understand yet. But I feel that we're an important part of it. Whatever this thing is that is consciousness is very much a part of it. I don't know what we're hooked to. I hope to do some writing on it someday and some speculation. But I think that we are an incredible creature to be able to do these things 15 billion years later. And I look forward to the things that that we will be able to do later. I think that the wisdom of the plan is that that we're trapped on this little planet, this speck of dust here, and we're it's fun to watch probably what's ahead for us. I think that without a doubt we're going to leave this planet, and in fact you can already see the beginning, the first steps of beginning to leave the nest already, the moon trip and these things, and the Mars trips that are coming up. Eventually we're going to move perhaps from childhood, racial childhood, into adolescence, at which point I have personally no doubt that we will begin to live in our solar system. All of the nine planets and dozens of moons of our solar system, the incredible raw material there is in this solar system, this hydrogen furnace, which is the sun, to supply us all the power that we need in the future. And I've no doubt that just as we on Earth have blazed skyways across the Earth and railroad lines and highways and all of that, we will do something equivalent in this solar system. I think that will be our growing up period, our adolescence to adulthood. And I think during the many, many millennia that in which we do this, I have no doubt but that we will grow to the point that we'll be able to attempt star travel. And only if all of the rest of the planets in the solar system and in the galaxy are protected from us. I would not want humans to go out and interfere with the workings of another world. We can already see in our time what they do with Vietnam and things like that. But when they achieve true adulthood in their own solar system, I think then they will be able to engage in star travel. And then we probably will meet the first other intelligent forms.
Just answered my next question. I was going to ask if you believe in life.
Because there's no point in trying to do a non-interview session. But although in this particular case we can, she need not be very much clear in it. She should be in it so our people can see and we can have the experience of what it is to have an interview.
Well, we'll just cut it together and see if we like it or not, and then decide if we want to do it that way. Since we're learning.
John knows the type of thing to cut away things, and as do you too.
A lot of these things have never been discussed in interviews with me, have they? The things you're talking about today.
Oh, they may have some magazine articles.
But I mean, never live on video?
No, never live on video. Has to be kept private, because by keeping it private, I feel that I can
talk a little bit about your families.
Okay.
And your children.
All right.
And how important all of them are to you as a person.
I think we must have that. No, I'm very happy. Thank you.
You look happy.
good company.
Would you tell us a little bit? Okay. Would you tell us a little bit about your family?
I've been very fortunate in family. I've had two marriages, both happy. In my first marriage, I had two lovely daughters, and I had the joy in that marriage of girls. And girls are such delicious, sweet-smelling, wonderful things. I can still remember when they would be so clean and their hair done, their starched dresses, and how when they would bend over, the dresses would come up, and that you'd see the panties, and it they just, little girls are just totally beautiful things, and I was happy, and I was lucky with my girls, and that they never had the problems that sometimes some people seem to have with girls. Not that my daughters didn't have their own problems of dating and so on, but it was never a problem for their parents. And I also then, in a second marriage, had the joy of, in a later part of my life, in my 50s, of having a son. Well, just as the daughters were just a total joy, having a son is an equal, not better, but equal, total joy. My boy, the males have a special thing about sons, and I have special relationships with my sons. I didn't have my daughters, and this vice versa happened. And he is today 14, beginning to go with girls, beginning to like girls, and I'm closer to him in this moment of his life than his mother, who has never had the urges of a boy with femaledom and the puzzlements and that sort of thing. You're a good makeup girl.
Can you think of some really special memories of things that have happened to you that involve your family? Things that just stick out in your mind?
Shut it off for a minute. I'd like to just think.
Stand by a second.
My daughters, in some ways, may have had an easier time in their relationship with me than my son has. Well, in some ways not. I was a bit harsher with my daughters because I was a much younger man, and a lot of my philosophies had not come about or had not matured. And I remember, not hard, but I remember spanking my daughters. And I know now that I need not have done that. And they remember me, and they, as they said once, they remember my gruff voice, since a male voice and the timbre of it used to frighten them, even when it wasn't meant to be an angry voice. But at the same time, they knew me when I was less, no one knew of Gene Roddenberry to speak of, and so they never had to judge themselves against a Gene Roddenberry of the popular image who has a hit series on the air and is become something of a public image. The worst that ever happened to my daughter was she had an English teacher who, rather liking me and becoming aware that I was a writer, used to say to my daughter, "I'm surprised that Gene Roddenberry's daughter should make that mistake in grammar." Little knowing that I knew practically nothing of grammar either. But they never had. My son, I fear that I've got to find ways of letting him know he's his own person in his own right. And the fact that I have some public image is not a thing of my making. It's the way the public goes about some things. And he must never judge himself by that perspective. anything he wants to do, he can do also too. And he is capable of doing. I just want to relieve him of any burden on his back of being my son.
What do you like best about each of your children?
I remember my children. I remember the first Darlene. She was precious and cool and proper in a lovely way. And I used to admire that. I admired my second daughter, Dawn, because she was vivacious and sort of not as quite as orderly. I remember her having imaginary pets, saying that she was keeping a horse behind the garage. And what kind of horse? She said it was a paint. Could I see it? No, it was still wet. My son, all boy. I enjoy everything he does. I enjoy him operating me for a new bicycle. I enjoy the fact that my present wife loves boys too. She bought him a motorcycle when he was 5 years old, which I refused to let him have. I put it up on, it was a little Italian thing, and I tied it up to some hooks in the garage. And she said, "Well, you're depriving our son." I said, "Well, anytime a bunch of his five-year-old friends come over and their motorcycles and want him to ride, well, I'll take his down and he can have it." But he's since become a motorcyclist in his 14 years. Children are just a complete joy. I remember with my daughters and their cousins going to dinner, and I would always have a pocket full of quarters. And I would say to them, like, the capital of England. And the first one that knew would get a quarter. And I would quiz them on all sorts of things. And my wife and my sister-in-law would get so into it that they would give answers to it. And I'd say, no quarters for adults, you know. What can I say about children? They are joy, just pure joy.
Did you plan the birth of your children?
Yes. Yes, the first two the first one I planned because when I was in the crash in the desert in Syria, I remember just before I went down, I just knew positively if I had left a child behind, I would not be dying. And so we had that baby 9 months after the day I returned. And then realizing that she would want a sister, she was very much planned. My son came along later, Majel, who wanted a boy in the worst way, even though I was in my 50s. But Majel wanted a little Jean Roddenberry, whatever the cost. And she went to doctors to find the best way to have a boy. Because she used to say, if I have a girl, they can take it back. And the systems work, and we indeed did have a son. And she insisted he be named Gene Roddenberry Jr., which I opposed, and then backed off on the proviso that he would not be called Little Gene or Jr., that he could be called Rod, which is a name I was called by in the service, and I told him, I'm loaning you my service name. And he's still called Rod today.
Would you tell the story about your son being born?
Majel, Rod's mother, is a lovely, outspoken, slightly revolutionary woman. And she not only planned to have a boy and got the boy that she wanted, but I was in the hospital when she had him, And I remember the doctor coming out of the room, and his head was bent over, and he was shaking all over, and I thought, my God, what has happened? And I rushed over to him, and I said, Doctor, what's wrong, what's wrong? And he turned to me, and I could see he was laughing. And I said, well, what? He said, oh, your wife. He says, I just had the baby and just put it up by its feet in front of her to assure her that it was breathing, and it says, we do. And she looked up and she said, thank God he's well hung. And I said, Majel, you know, mothers are supposed to count fingers and toes. She says, I count what's important. And that is typically Majel. She's part of her loveliness is in her directness and honesty and her lack of reverence for things that other people are reverent about. And I love that.
That's it? Okay. What achievements in life are you most proud of?
When I'm asked about achievements that I'm proud of, I don't think in terms of achievement. I'm most proud of the fact that I live life as fully as I can. I do not consider Gene Roddenberry anyone special. I do not consider Gene Roddenberry particularly intelligent or thoughtful or philosophical. I think Gene Roddenberry is a person who had the good fortune to have parents that aimed him in a certain direction, who met people during his life and read books during his life that helped him do things and become things that he wanted. And if I have any achievement I'm proud of, it's the achievement of being able to sit down and work hard. A lot of things people would call achievements really came out of the fact that I was handicapped as a child. During this time, I learned to concentrate completely on stories and dreams. And I can work today on a script and have the room full of people. I often have a problem with friends. Something will be said and it will start a train of thought in my mind. I've learned to be able to look them right in the eye and nod at all the appropriate time without the slightest idea of what they're talking about. And fortunately, when I see them hesitate, I'm able to pull back in my mind the memory of the last few words that was said, and then I fake it from then on. I don't want to be like that, but it's just this mechanism that goes click into a daydream without any warning. But I make a living out of that, writing them down, and I'm not unhappy with that.
What do you like to daydream about?
I like to daydream about anything and everything. My wife, Majel, will occasionally come in my room, and I always have a stack of books by my bed. I read a couple or three books a week, and she'll often come in and say, pick a book off the top of the pile and say, ah, well, what are you going to become now, an explorer? Or there was a book the other day on the Battle of Jutland in World War I, a naval battle. And she says, what are you going to become, an admiral now? And she's joking those things because it puzzles her that I'm an omnivorous reader. I can be reading, I can read a recent books I've read was the fantasies, the New York, let me give us a cut now, Bonfire of the Vanities. Yeah.
Okay, hold on a second. Take it up to speed. Give me time.
For example, I recently read Bonfire of the Vanities. It's a bestseller today. It's a New York located story, modern day. And a short time afterwards, I was reading A Short History of Time by the brilliant scientist whose name I've forgotten, but who's probably the brightest man alive on the planet today. I'm an omnivorous reader. If I'm deprived of books, I suppose I would read the telephone book. You get that way as a reader.
Other than reading, what do you do for fun and relaxation?
Recently, I went sailplaning, and that was great fun to be up there in the silence of a sailplane. Shh, as you come down. And I've always liked flying, and that is part of it. I'm a good sailor. I used to race sailboats along the Pacific here. I don't do it now. I sold my boat because I took up golf. And golf, taking 4 hours a day when you play it, doesn't leave you much time for sailboating. I don't know what my next hobby will be, but it will certainly be fun and interesting, and I just live. And
do you have any strong political leanings?
My political leanings are that of a liberal, and at times revolutionary liberal. My wife, when I joined a right-wing country club I belonged to, was asked, was I for a certain political leader? And she said, no, he would probably be for Mao Zedong, except he's not running now. That was a joke, but for a while it gave me trouble in the country club till they began to become proud of the fact that I was a writer, and writers are supposed to have crazy ideas.
No, we
probably got enough, haven't we?
Yeah, unless if there's a comment that you want to make about something that you feel that I didn't address, that we can just tag it on to the next reel, and if not, we can say stop.
No, I think I don't have any right now, anyway.
Up here? We've covered a lot of ground.
Sure.
Then we can quit this part.
What were the questions you said you wanted to cover in a message to his children?
I think we did that. I made a note of it anyway.
Okay,
you want me to start with the introduction, even though we've already done that?
Sure, why not?
Okay, we'll do it again while he's here.
Okay.
I'm talking with writer-producer Gene Roddenberry at his house in Carlsbad, California. Mr. Roddenberry, when you were a child, you used to play in boxes all the time. Would you tell me about those boxes?
I sure would.
Let's go on to the next one.
Okay. I'm just going to ask a row of questions.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Let's see. Where did I start?
Okay.
I'm talking with writer-producer Gene Roddenberry at his home in Carlsbad, California. Mr. Roddenberry, when you were a child, you used to play in boxes all the time. Would you tell me about those boxes?
When I read, like today, my lips move. But I don't think he sees it. Do you want me to seem to be talking?
This is that.
Okay, you want me to go on to the next question? Okay. Tell about some of your favorite childhood memories.
Okay.
Okay.
Do you want me to start again? Okay. Why did you read so much as a child?
Because I kept hoping to find you in one of the books.
Did I get to be your heroine? tell me about your parents.
They were people, but not many people believed it.
What was your happiest childhood memory?
The first time I masturbated.
I can't give a straight face on that. What did you want to be when you grew up?
I can't think of anything that funny.
Okay, I'll say it straight. What did you want to be when you grew up?
A burglar. And perhaps a rapist when I grew to that point.
How did you get to California?
Hitchhiked on Southern Pacific, taking my mother along on my back.
What did you daydream about as a child?
Girls, constantly.
What did it feel like the first time you flew an airplane by yourself?
Heavenly, really. It was almost as good as masturbation. It was.
Trying to think what else I asked. Oh, did anything frightening ever happen to you in an airplane?
Yes, one time I lost my erection. We were about to crash.
You always got them when you flew, right?
Yes.
Let's see.
Children, you want to ask me about
your
family?
Yeah, I want to ask you about your family.
I've
got it over here. Was your family affectionate when you were growing up?
Mm-hmm, yes.
Do I need to do that one again? Did we walk over each other? Okay.
I did.
Okay. Was your family affectionate when you were growing up?
Yes.
What are some special memories that you have about your families?
They threw me out of the house on a cold, cold night.
Tell me about your children.
Well, there are 15.
What am I doing? Okay, is that better? How far back do I need to go to get away from the doorknob?
Back to the two or three of them.
Okay.
Are you leaning in again?
I am? Okay. Is that better?
Yes.
Then I probably was leaning in before, too, because I always leaned to my left. Okay. Okay. Tell me about your families.
I did not have as many children as I tried to have.
What are some special things about your children?
That's too happy a subject to joke about.
What are some special things about your children?
Their intelligence, their happiness.
What are some of Gene Roddenberry's strong beliefs?
I believe in the devil. And I believe he has backed me ably all through my life.
Let's see. Is that enough, John? Are you...
Let's get something of you listening, not smiling.
Okay.
Okay, well, I want to talk about the devil. What I like about the devil is he's taught me to do things that get around my wife. He's taught me to lie ably. He has taught me to... Well, mainly he's teaches you to lie. The devil is very good at that. And helps you become a writer. Because when you're writing, you're almost always lying. Or sometimes you're giving you're turning your dreams into stories. That's the fun of writing. You'd like to write. You do write, I'm sure. And, why don't you do a Star Trek? And can you see my lips moving?
Yes.
Okay. Well, she has a nice nod, doesn't she?
Had enough?
Sure.
Okay, what's next, director?
No, we've probably got enough to make something out of it.
Okay. I'd like to write a Star Trek. I'd like to be in a Star Trek once.
You're good. Why don't you come out sometime? I'll have you on set, both of you.
We'd like that. Oh, we would like that. I'll have to figure a way to do that.
I enjoy watching how they work.
I would like to see how they work. Mm. I really would.
Okay.
Are we done?
Anything else on me? I think that's a wrap, unless someone's got something else.
I got nothing else.
Let's go home and look at it and edit and play games.
Go home and see what we missed.
Right. Yeah, we will have missed some things.
Oh, yeah.
We will have missed some things.
Of course, you'll say. Oh, good. God, why didn't, you know?
I know it. This. Well, that's what we'll learn. It's what did we miss.
Okay.
Okay, can I unhook, can I unhook myself, Jonathan? Done.
Doesn't matter to me.
It doesn't matter to me.